We all know about the Russian Revolution of 1917, but what about the Russian Revolution of 1905? Or perhaps more specifically, why did the regime of the Tsar survive this widespread revolution? And what did it achieve? That and more you'll find out today. Good to have you back on the channel, and if you happen to be new, my name is Stefan and I'm hustling history for you. And if you liked it, then consider subscribing and also hit the notification bell to join the hustle. A revolution is a swift and radical change. There were four major problems in Russian society that caused this revolution. There were agrarian problems. Peasants lived in extreme poverty and were oppressed by their landlords. Second, national minorities felt alienated because of the oppressive nature of the Russian government. They were discriminated against. Also, the industrial working class resented the government because strikes and labor unions were forbidden. And also, the educated classes were against the regime and wanted liberal reforms that granted them more freedom. And then early 1904, the Russo-Japanese War started because of Russian overconfidence, logistical problems, and incapable command. The Russians suffered defeat after defeat in the Far East. And these defeats attributed to the Russian Revolution of 1905. And this revolution kicked off on Sunday, the 9th of January, or 22nd of January, according to the Gregorian calendar. Key figure was Father Georgy Gapon. He had studied at the Theological Academy of Saint Petersburg, and he went into the working class neighborhoods to preach and gained more and more popularity among the working class. He also set up tea houses as some kind of a cultural mission. Each meeting started with a prayer and ended with the Russian national anthem. But the movement was soon transformed into an independent labor union, the Assembly of Russian Factory and Mill Workers, which, despite its loyal surface, demanded radical reforms, including the establishment of a government responsible to the people, a progressive income tax, trade union rights, and an 8-hour day. The reform program would have acquired the complete restructuring of the state, yet said nothing about how this was to be achieved. Gapon wasn't aware of what the political consequences were of his religious efforts. He always portrayed a picture of the Tsar as a noble father that wanted what's best for its people. From the 3rd to the 8th of January 1905, in St. Petersburg, over 120,000 people went on strike. And they proposed to Gapon to visit the Tsar to seek truth and justice. Gapon, he agreed, and he made a list of demands. On the 7th, the authorities, they urged Gapon to call off the march that was planned on Sunday, the 9th. But Gapon, he didn't call it off. And so, on Sunday, the 9th of January 1905, over 100,000 workers, intelligentsia, women and children that had banners with portraits of the Tsar and religious icons, they walked towards the Winter Palace in St. Petersburg. The people approached the Narva gates and were attacked by a squadron of cavalry. Many continued their advance towards the lines of soldiers that fired two warning salvos and then fired directly at the unarmed crowd. Around 200 people died and 800 were wounded, and that day lived on as Bloody Sunday. A Bolshevik who was there, he later claimed that this was the beginning of the revolution, as he wrote, "I saw these looks of hatred and vengeance on literally every face, old and young, men and women. The revolution had been truly born, and it had been born in the very core, in the very bowels of the people." The riots continued the following day, and in the weeks after Bloody Sunday, countless of strikes occurred throughout the empire. This was the largest labor protest in Russian history. But these strikes weren't that well organized and were more spontaneous outbursts of anger. Mostly the demands were written down after the first protests had occurred. Socialist parties were too weak to play a major role in this, simply due to the fact that most of its leaders were living in exile. Gapon, in the meanwhile, had fled to Finland. The running continued to be made by the liberal and democratic opposition. See, the intelligentsia was also outraged by the killings that occurred on Bloody Sunday. The mood of rebellion soon spread to the countryside. The peasants, they saw this as a chance to rebel against their landowners, and the anger of the peasants was strengthened when the harvest had failed once again that summer. Countless landowners had to flee, and over 3,000 manors were burned down to the ground. In some areas, self-proclaimed peasants' republics saw the light of day. They espoused the ideals of political reform, of a constitution and a parliament, and of better education for the peasants in addition to land reform. Their aim was to end the dark and backward ways of the villages, to bring them the benefits of the modern world, and to end their isolation by integrating them into national politics. The army cracked down hard on these rebellions. Between January and October that year, the army intervened around 2,700 times. The problem was that many soldiers in the army used to be peasants themselves, and therefore mutinies occurred that were also strengthened by the defeats the Russian army suffered in the Far East against the war with Japan. Most noteworthy was the mutiny on the battleship of Potemkin, which sailed for Odessa. These events were later dramatized by Soviet cinematographer Sergei Eisenstein. A crowd of civilians was mowed down as they descended the broad steps leading to the harbor. The slaughter provided the subject of one of the great scenes of modern history. As eyeglasses shattered and a baby carriage bumped its way down the stairs, the victims were an innocent, indeed bourgeois public. And also the non-Russian people within the empire, they grabbed their chance to revolt. In Riga, the demonstration was crushed by the authorities. In the Polish territories, there were more strikes than in the rest of the empire, especially in the textile city of Łódź. Also here, the government acted severe. In Finland, the governor general was murdered, and in parts of Georgia, the government lost control for 2 years. As a US consul in Batumi wrote, "Russia is permeated with sedition and seeking with revolution, racial hatred and warfare, murder, incendiarism, brigandage, robbery and crime of every kind. As far as can be seen, we are on the high road to complete anarchy and social chaos." Tsar Nicholas II had now two options: either install a military dictatorship or issue reforms, and he chose the latter option as he issued the October Manifesto, which was drafted by Sergei Witte, in which he granted civil liberties, a constitutional order, cabinet government, and a legislative Duma elected on a democratic franchise. After its announcement, people went to the streets to celebrate, but there were also negative results. Extreme right-wing parties such as the Black Hundreds organized pogroms against the people they deemed at fault, the Jews. After the Tsar had issued his manifesto, over 690 registered pogroms took place, in which 3,000 people died and countless of people lost their homes. But it seemed like a new Russia was born. But was this Russia going to last? No. Thanks to my patrons, and a special thanks to Peter King, Tanya Dixie, Henry Clarkson, Rob Park, RL, and Colin Castleman. And this was the second video of the video series about revolutionary Russia, in which I will discuss the road to the Russian Revolution and also its bloody aftermath with all its complications. And we talk about army formations and factions and so on and so forth. So I hope you find it interesting. Do subscribe and let me know if there are some topics, even some niche topics within this topic of revolutionary Russia you want me to cover. I look forward to your replies. Thank you so much for watching. До свидания.